Hi, welcome to the Museum of Northern Arizona. My name is Tony Thibodeau, and I am the curator for The Forces With Our People, an exhibit that we've had up here at the museum for just over a year now, actually. And if you're just joining us for this tour today and haven't been on any of the previous tours, this is an exhibit where we've been exploring the connections between the Star Wars cultural phenomenon and contemporary Native art and Native artists on the Colorado Plateau. We've done several virtual tours highlighting several artists in this exhibit, but what I'd like to do today is maybe highlight some of the artists that we haven't spotlighted very much. So let's get started. I got a whole list of artists to go through, so come along. So I thought I'd start with this wall here. These are pieces by Mavasta Hanyuti, who's a wood carver from Hopi. And Mavasta does a lot of different carvings. He does more traditional work. He does 3D pieces. But these pieces are more of a plaque, right? And so he incorporates a lot of pop culture themes into his work. So these pieces are on loan to us for the exhibit, and we're really fortunate to have them. Really cool pieces. Not only, it's hard to tell maybe through the video, but they are somewhat three-dimensional, where they're etched, and there's a little bit of relief in some of these as well. So very cool piece. Three pieces there. The two pieces next to them are by Jason Garcia, who is from the Santa Clara Pueblo. Tewa Pueblo in northern New Mexico. These pieces by Jason are both ceramic tiles. It may be hard to tell there, but they are traditionally fired using traditional Pueblo firing techniques, fired outside, using traditional Pueblo clays. So Jason is an accomplished potter, but he's also a master printmaker. A lot of the work that Jason's been doing recently is print work. And so he actually has a master's in fine art from the University of Wisconsin. So I'm sure all you Badgers fans out there will appreciate that. But yeah, Jason's work is really cool. We're really happy to have that, his work in the exhibit. Standing next to some design elements in the gallery, Darvin and I are going to try to point out some of these today too. All of the design work on the walls that you see were done by Dwayne Koyawina, a Hopi artist local here in Flagstaff, who's helped us on a variety of different exhibits, has some pieces in the exhibit, including Hopi R2, which I know a lot of people have seen before, but Dwayne was really gracious in helping us decorate this gallery with some really cool artwork. This is one of his AT-ST walkers right here on the wall. Moving along on this wall, these are pieces by Dale DeForest. He's a Navajo artist based out of Albuquerque. And Dale works in a variety of different graphic arts, does a lot of comic book work. So his comic books are really cool if you want to check those out. But this is sort of a series that Dale did of Star Wars figures reimagined as sometimes somewhat notable figures from the Navajo Nation. And so it's kind of reimagining those real life people as characters from the Star Wars universe. And the image in the middle here, this is, of course, you know, kind of taking off from the Rey character from the most recent Star Wars films. And Dale's done a couple of images where he's, you know, envisioning Rey as a Navajo heroine. And of course, if you've been to the exhibit, you've probably seen Desba Rose's cosplay, where she cosplayed the Rey character as an indigenous figure, an indigenous heroine. And so Dale has done some pieces where, you know, he's kind of riffing off of the work that Desba's done. So we kind of mounted these on the wall in sort of a almost kind of mimicking a panel or a page in a comic book, because you know we're kind of referencing Dale's comic book work. Moving along, these are two prints by Darby Raymond Overstreet. She's another Navajo or Diné artist based out of Albuquerque. She does, in addition to digital prints like these, she also does some beadwork as well. And we'll go take a look at some of her beadwork in a minute. But she did these two pieces, Kylo Ren, which she calls Kylo Ren Renewal, and on the right here, Darth Vader Redemption, kind of two obviously very prominent figures in the Star Wars universe, you know, kind of encompassing very similar themes in Star Wars. But I think if you could get in there a little bit close again, you can see some of the detail, thanks Darvin, in her digital work. Really cool stuff. So let's go over and take a look at some of Darby's beadwork. So there's a series here of Darby's beadwork. These are bracelets, beaded bracelets, and different, you know, lightsabers from the Star Wars universe in different colors, the red, the purple, the green, two shades of blue, really. And so Darby does a lot of really incredible beadwork. And I'll mention this a couple of times, but, you know, many of the artists that are in this exhibit are, you know, they're current contemporary artists who are doing work right now. If you're interested in any of the work that you see by any of the artists in this exhibit, I really encourage people to go to their websites, their Instagram accounts, their Facebook pages, and a lot of these artists have some incredible work that's for sale. Also in this case, we have some other jewelry. There's some silver pieces. Those are pieces by Cynthia Begay, and she's Hopi Diné. She's based out of California, Southern California. These pieces, they're done in the Hopi overlay style, and she has a very unique process that she uses to create these works. She first creates them in the traditional Hopi overlay technique, laying two pieces of silver over each other, cutting the design out of the top piece. But then she uses a process called lost wax casting to make duplicates of that piece. And so it's a very old, ancient technique that she's adapted for her own style. But she uses this process of essentially creating a rubber mold, and then she uses that to duplicate the piece in wax, and then in plaster, and then finally in silver, so she can make multiple kind of limited editions of these pieces. Also in this case is another silver piece. There's a Millennium Falcon bracelet done in the Navajo sandcast technique. Unfortunately, we don't know who the artist is. We acquired this piece just on eBay. One of our staff members encountered it, thought it would be a great addition for the exhibit, a great addition for the museum. But unfortunately, we don't know the name of the artist. So I want to encourage people, you know, I work in collections most of the time, and I want to encourage people, if you're buying artwork by any artist, not just Native artists, try to keep those records. If you ever think you may pass it down to somebody in your family or donate it to a museum, that kind of information is really important for people to know later on. And especially, you know, 50 years ago when people were collecting Native art, a lot of times people didn't really even think to, you know, write down the name of the artist. Of course, a lot of artists now have business cards, they have websites and things like that. But at the time, you know, 50 years ago, a lot of people just didn't even think to like just jot down the name of the artist. And so it's really interesting and helpful to know. One more piece before we leave in here is this beaded piece by Raymond Trujillo. He's a beadwork artist from Laguna Pueblo in New Mexico. And this is a piece that, of course, it has the Boba Fett helmet in there. And he calls this one Christmas Special. And if you're a Star Wars geek, you probably get that reference right away. It's a reference to the Star Wars Holiday Special that was released, I believe, in 1978, shortly after the release of the first film, but before the release of Empire Strikes Back. And it's essentially, go to YouTube and just, you know, search for a Star Wars Holiday Special. I applaud you if you can get through the whole thing. Most of the actors and producers of Star Wars have sort of distanced themselves. I think that's the only place where it exists is on YouTube. But it's essentially like a 1970s style variety show that is extremely campy, really cheeky, and it's funny in parts, but it's pretty cringy in a lot of other parts. But one interesting thing about the holiday special is that it is part of the Star Wars canon, because it is the first appearance of Boba Fett. Even before Boba Fett appeared in Empire Strikes Back, there's a short animated piece, which is probably, I think, the highlight of the holiday special. A short animated piece in the holiday special that features Boba Fett. And so, that's what Raymond is referencing here in this piece. Let's jump over to another case. Ray's got another piece over here I wanted to point out. Just real quick, here's another piece by Raymond Trujillo from Laguna Pueblo. This is his Vader hat, beadwork on a trucker hat, also just kind of showing, Ray's skill at beadwork. And I follow him on Instagram and Facebook, and he's always got really cool pop culture themed pieces that he's working on. So I encourage you to track him down online and check out his work. All right, we're gonna move over to the middle of the gallery and talk about this piece of pottery real quick. And I'm not sure if Darwin can catch a lot of this, but hopefully you can see some of the pieces on the work on this piece. This is by Susan Folwell. She's another artist from Santa Clara Pueblo in northern New Mexico. And this is a jar that is on loan to us for the exhibit from the Fred Jones Jr. Museum of Art at the University of Oklahoma. And a special thank you to the Fred Jones Museum for loaning us this piece. It's really an incredible piece, lots of detail. I know Darwin, I think, has shown some of the top there and some of the sides, but I really, for me, the coolest part about this piece is the bottom. It is completely painted with the Death Star and Star Wars X-Wing fighters. I think there's some TIE fighters in there as well. That's why we have it mounted on a mirror so that you can see the bottom of the piece, because unless you turn that jar upside down, it's really hard to see those. But it's just a really cool piece, and we're very, again, thankful to the Fred Jones Museum of Art for loaning it to us for the exhibit. Let's turn around and we'll talk about a couple other pieces in the middle of the room. These are by Rod Velarde. And Rod is an artist, a Jicarilla Apache artist from Dulce, New Mexico, up way up northern New Mexico, almost the Colorado border, really. And Rod does a lot of different work. He does limited prints and drawings, again, using this really intricate, these intricate designs. That he, he's inspired by his own Apache culture, but also by some of the artwork that you see on Pueblo pottery in northern New Mexico. So kind of this cultural influence there. This is a piece that's owned by a collector in Albuquerque. We're really thankful that we can borrow this piece, this Vader helmet. It is a wearable Vader helmet. I've never worn it, of course, but Rod, he kind of specializes, he does t-shirts and he does prints, but he also specializes in taking, essentially off-the-shelf toys that are created for the Star Wars collector market, and then customizing them and essentially indigenizing them by incorporating indigenous designs. This piece is done with just a marker on the plastic, but let's bounce over to this piece over here. So this is a BB-8 toy that Rod also did. And in addition to the painting, he also, there's a lot of etch work in there. So I'm not sure if you can see it, but there's a bit of relief there in the designs. Again, using those really, really intricate geometric designs. This is an off-the-shelf BB-8 toy that he, really made it his own and made it his own style. So we're really thankful. This is on loan to us from Rod, and we're really thankful to have this piece in the show as well. Okay, let's move over to the wall over here. And in the past, I think I've talked about a number of these pieces. The front wall mostly is all Ryan Singer pieces. I think we've talked about those in a lot of other videos. This giant watercolor piece right here is a piece by Bahi Whitethorn Sr. This is part of the museum's collection. We incorporated this into the show because we were talking about kind of the mythological elements of Star Wars and how those may parallel mythological elements in Native oral traditions. Right next to that, to Bahi's piece, is two pieces by Sean Bayali, who's a Diné artist based out of Winslow, and so also more or less local. Sean works in a very much a comic book style. Some color pieces, a color piece that he did there, and then the black and white piece. The piece on the top is he calls Navajo Jedi Twins, and so similar to the piece by Bahi next to it, basically, well, Sean's really imagining that the story of the hero twins as Star Wars, incorporating a Star Wars element to it. The one below is called Navajo Sheep Herder. All right, let's move on down. This is a piece by Kim Lonis, and she's a Diné artist, lives just outside of Flagstaff on the Navajo Nation, and she does a lot of interesting beadwork. And it's very much an abstract piece that's inspired by BB-8, of course. But I just love how the light hits this piece and the intricacy on this piece. The beadwork to me is just incredible on here. So again, we're really thankful to Kim for loaning us this piece for the exhibit. Right next to Kim's piece is by Jonathan Nelson, a Diné artist who's based out of Denver, Colorado. And I met Jonathan, like many of the other artists that are in this exhibit, I met Jonathan at an Indigenous Comic-Con several years ago and sort of became familiar with his work. And of course, Indigenous Comic-Con started by Dr. Lee Francis in Albuquerque as a convention, a pop culture convention, that really celebrates Indigenous art that's inspired by pop culture. So of course, in Jonathan's piece here, Farm Wars Resistance, he's envisioning Princess Leia as a Navajo sheep. I love his work, it's so playful. If you're familiar with some of his work, you may have seen that he has a comic book called Jonesy that features a sheep on the Navajo Nation and the adventures of this sheep living on the Navajo Nation. Is just really, really incredible stuff, really, really cool. And we're really thankful for Jonathan. This is actually loaned to us by a collector down in Scottsdale. But Jonathan joined us at the opening last year when we had an artist panel. And I really appreciate him and all the other artists that helped us out with that panel. Okay, we're gonna kind of move around the corner here. Actually, Darvid, if you want to try to catch the element, the designs on the wall here, again, these are by Dwayne Coyuina. This side in the red is, of course, Darth Vader. And then if you want to pan around the other side, you can see the light side, right? That's Yoda on that side. And a little funny story about this piece. When I was talking to Dwayne more than a year ago about this exhibit in the gallery and kind of how, what kind of designs, we wanted to have in here for the exhibit. I had this toy, I should have brought it with me today, but it's this cube that I got back when the prequels came out, right? In the late 90s, if any of you remember that. When those prequels came out, they did a whole tie-in with Taco Bell and Kentucky Fried Chicken and all these fast food restaurants, of course, had all these toys came out. So I had this toy from Taco Bell. There was this cube, and it had this, this kind of trick with mirrors in it where you looked at it from one angle and it was Darth Vader, and you looked at it from another angle and it was Yoda. So I brought that over and showed it to Dwayne, and I was like, dude, this is what I want. This is how I envision this to be on this corner. So that's kind of where that came from. And Dwayne, with this piece, as well as all the other designs in this exhibit. I don't know if you've noticed, we'll try to maybe hit the blue one when we get on this wall, but he did some lightsabers on the wall that I think came out really cool as well. Okay, so these three pieces right here, these are by Randall J. Wilson, who's a Navajo artist based here in Flagstaff. If you're familiar with the exhibit, you've probably recognized the Che Yoda painting right there. That was used for our banner. It was also used in some of the stickers that we did to promote the exhibit. Really cool, kind of envisioning Yoda as a Dene elder, right? Really cool piece. Right next to it, the Boba So, that piece right there, the Boba, the hunter figure with the keto or the armband. And then next to it below, sorry, I'm probably moving too fast, but is Boba Yazi. And if you're a Star Wars geek, you probably remember which episode this is referencing. I believe it's episode 2, Attack of the Clones, when Boba Fett, his father Jango Fett dies, right? And he's holding that helmet, I think. If not, I'm sure somebody will correct me in the comments. Please do. So again, really thankful to, these are actually owned by Randall's cousin. Really thankful to Randall and his cousin for lending us these pieces for the exhibit. Right next to Randall's pieces are two prints by Randy Kemp, who's a Choctaw, Muscogee Creek, and Yuchi artist. He's based out of Phoenix. So, you know, you might wonder, well, why is there a Choctaw, Muscogee Creek, Yuchi artist in this exhibit celebrating the Colorado Plateau? Well, I ran into Randy a couple years ago at a museum conference. He was selling his work down in Phoenix, and saw these pieces and, you know, realized that we needed to have them for the exhibit just because they were so cool. His interpretation of the Wookiee, this one here, well, downtown Wookiee is this one right here, of a Wookiee just kind of cruising, you know, in a downtown cityscape, which I just love. I love the movement that he uses here in this piece. And then the piece next to it is Western Wookiee of Klagato, sort of envisioning a Wookiee as, you know, as a chief or a chairman of a tribe. So I think the color, I think, is fantastic in this too, the blues and the greens. All right, we're going to move right next to Randy's work. These are three pieces by Mike Toya. Again, another artist who I primarily first met through the Indigenous Comic-Con, when I first started going to that in 2016, met Mike and saw his work there and was just kind of blown away by, again, the detail and the intricacy in his work. This is a piece he calls Maiden Leia. I know we've posted images of this, I think, on Facebook, and people love it. Again, you know, imagining Leia as an Indigenous woman with the hair whorls that, of course, are common traditional for Pueblo and Hopi women hairstyles. And, you know, a lot of discussion about, you know, did he steal the idea for those hairstyles for Leia, or did they come from somewhere else? Really interesting discussion. I won't weigh too much into that, but I think, you know, Lucas has acknowledged that he was inspired from many different cultures all over the world by different cultural elements. Things like the Darth Vader helmet is very much inspired by Japanese samurai helmets. And so he has acknowledged that he's pulled, you know, from different cultures all over the world. And, you know, it does bring up really interesting issues of cultural appropriation and where is the line of inspiration and appropriation. And so something I think that Mike's work, especially in this piece, really gets into. Here's another of his two pieces here. The top one he calls Warrior's Apprentice, with Darth Maul in the middle, Indigenous warrior on one side, and then Darth Vader on the other side. I just love the kind of images within an image that Mike uses like this image right here, if you can see it. I'm not absolutely sure, but that looks like downtown Albuquerque to me. Mike is from Jemez Pueblo, but he's based out of Isleta Pueblo, which, if you're familiar with the area around Albuquerque, is just on the south end of Albuquerque. And this piece down below he calls Chief Yoda. Again, I think as Randall's piece, and I think Dale has a piece as well, they're, you know, imagining Yoda as an indigenous elder, which I think there's some obvious parallels and connections there that are really cool. This is a piece right next to it, the Mike's pieces. This is by Landis Bahi. He's another Diné artist who's based here in Albuquerque. We're not in Albuquerque, we're in Flagstaff. Landis is based here in Flagstaff. Landis is a tattoo artist here in Flagstaff, does really incredible tattoo work. He did this Boba Fett inspired piece for the exhibit. I had worked with Landis before on the exhibit that we had in here before this exhibit called Pivot Skateboard Art, Skateboard Deck Art. And that exhibit, if you're not aware, if you saw that exhibit here at the museum, it was so cool. We had, you know, 100 different skateboard decks in here, hand painted by, I think it was 32 or 33 different indigenous artists. That exhibit went on to BIME, and now it's just opened at Fort Lewis College at the museum there in Durango, Colorado. So if you're in Southern Colorado or you're going through Southern Colorado, taking a trip to Durango, go check out the Pivot Skateboard Deck Art exhibit at Fort Lewis College. Okay, so finally, we have two pieces on the end of the wall over here by Shandine Yesilth. She's a young Navajo artist based out of Phoenix, actually, because she was a student at Arizona State University. I believe she's graduated already, but when I met her last year, she was working on a degree in construction management. But she's also a really talented artist, and this is a great example of somebody who I never would have known about without help from an artist in the exhibit. So Randy Kemp, whose work we just looked at, you know, I'd asked him about his pieces, and he said, well, you know, I know this other young artist, you might be interested in her work as well. She uses some Star Wars themes in her work as well. And so contacted Shandine, and we were able to borrow these pieces from her for the exhibit. To me, it's a great example of the collaborative nature of this exhibit. You know, I curated this exhibit, but I had so much help. Without all of the help that I had from the artists, from all of the artists, this project just wouldn't have happened. And so I'm really thankful to Randy, really thankful to Shandine, thankful to all the artists for their help and their contributions for this exhibit. So I think I'm going to stop there with objects, but I wanted to again take the opportunity to really promote these artists and their work and encourage people, if you saw anything in here that you liked, and I'm sure you did, to try to find those artists. Like many artists, not just Native artists, but like many artists right now, the global pandemic has really hit people hard. And especially with Native artists, with the loss of a lot of the markets and fairs that they're usually selling their work at, without those outlets, a lot of artists have gone almost completely to selling their work online. And so many of the artists in this exhibit, obviously many other artists and Native artists have an online web store, or you can go to their Instagram page, and sometimes people will post things that are for sale. So I encourage, you know, we're coming up on the holiday season, coming up on the gift buying and giving season. A great way to support Native artists right now is to buy their work. And again, I encourage you, if you're interested in a specific artist, maybe having a hard time finding their web store or their contact, post a comment next to this video, and we'll try to give you post up some information about how to find their work. Cool. So another thing I wanted to mention is the Plateau Magazine. This is a magazine that we publish here at the Museum of Northern Arizona. It's essentially the exhibit catalog for this exhibit. So if you don't get a chance to come see it, and you want to, you know, have something to take a look at, you know, we have a lot of the interpretive text is in here. All of the text that is on the walls, including the interpretive text that I wrote. There's text in here by Manny Wheeler, who's the director of the Navajo Nation Museum and was really instrumental in the Navajo Star Wars project of translating the first Star Wars film into the Diné language. He's got a couple essays in here. There's an essay by Lee Francis talking about Indigenous Comic-Con and Indigenous cosplay and the importance, that intersection between popular culture and Native art. So not only is the text from the exhibit in here, we've expanded some of that text. So you can get kind of a deeper dive into this exhibit. And of course, there's beautiful full color images of all of the artwork from this exhibit in here. In addition to the artwork, there's also the statements and quotes by different artists. I did a series of interviews at Indigenous Comic-Con in 2018, preparing for this exhibit. So there's lots of quotes from artists about how and why they've been inspired by Star Wars and inspired enough to incorporate it into their work. So those statements those quotes are in here, and then we followed up with many other artists to get statements. Artists that we weren't able to do full interviews with, we were able to get statements. So for me, that's some of the most interesting interpretive parts of this exhibit is what the artists have to say for themselves about Star Wars and Native contemporary art. So if you haven't got yourself a copy yet, it's for sale on the Museum of Northern Arizona web store. Of course, if you're in the museum, we've got it in the shop as well. And so I encourage you, if you're interested, to pick up a copy of The Plateau. I also have an article that I've been working on. It's more of an academic article that's for an academic volume to be published by Wilfrid Laurier University Press out of Canada. I'm hoping, if you're familiar with academic presses, it's usually a very long timetable. So I'm hopeful that that article will be coming out and that volume will be coming out sometime next year. But I kind of dive into kind of the more fandom studies elements of this exhibit and look at it through concepts like participatory culture and things like that that are really prominent in fandom studies. So keep an eye out for that. So another thing I wanted to mention is a lot of people have asked me about future plans to travel this exhibit. And though we had a great deal of interest in traveling this exhibit to other museums contacted us even before the exhibit opened when we started promoting it. We started working on those travel plans early last spring. Of course, like everything else, the global pandemic impacted those plans. So we basically shelved any ideas about traveling the exhibit, both from our own perspective, it's a lot of resources and staff time on our part. And then, other museums are having their own issues right now in terms of their exhibit schedule and funding and things like that. So right now we don't have any concrete arrangements to travel the exhibit anywhere else, but we're working on a plan to be able to do that. Maybe next year, if we have the opportunity, we'll be able to do this exhibit at another museum. And so keep an eye on the museum's website, keep an eye on the museum's Facebook page. If we have any plans to travel it somewhere else, I would love to see it go somewhere in New Mexico. Since so many of the artists in here are based out of New Mexico, I think the exhibit would be a great fit somewhere in New Mexico as well. So we're hoping for that. So I just wanted to take a final moment to do a bunch of thank yous. Thank you again to all of the artists that participated in the exhibit. Thanks as well to Manny Wheeler at the Navajo Nation Museum for their support, loaning us the video about Navajo Star Wars and really and Manny's work doing writing the essays for the interpretation in the exhibit and for the plateau. I want to thank again Lee Francis at Red Planet Books, which is Lee's bookstore in Albuquerque, New Mexico. If you're in or around Albuquerque, go check out Red Planet Books. It's a really cool bookstore that features indigenous authors, indigenous books, and lots of indigenous created comic books and got lots of prints and cool stuff like that. Lee also runs Native Realities Publishing, where that company publishes work by indigenous authors and artists. I want to thank also for the financial support from several of our donors. We had a bunch of really generous donors locally who helped with this exhibit, performance staffing here in Flagstaff, the Narba Institute here in Flagstaff. Special thanks to Dwayne Coyuina for his fantastic graphic elements in the exhibit, his work with Hopi R2, which we didn't really talk too much about today, but we've got a lot of videos up there on our Facebook page about Hopi R2, so check those out if you haven't seen those. And then also Dwayne was so gracious with his time in helping me do a lot of different interviews. We've gotten a lot of great media attention for this exhibit, and Dwayne was always really gracious with his time and helping me do some of those interviews because he's local here in Flagstaff, so that was great. I wanted to thank some of the media outlets for the coverage, Arizona Daily Sun, Flagstaff Live, KNAU, local NPR affiliate here in Flagstaff, did a great story. Ryan Hunches did a great story on this exhibit, and then that actually got picked up by Morning Edition, NPR Morning Edition. So that's floating around out there as well on NPR. The Navajo Hopi Observer did a great story for us on us. Native American Art Magazine, the Durango Herald, the weekly paper, the DGO out of Durango. Nick Gonzalez did a fantastic article on this exhibit there. Forbes.com, there was a great article that you can find online if you want to track that one down. And then also another radio interview that Dwayne and I did was for CBC, the Canadian Broadcasting Company, for a show called Unreserved, which focuses on First Nations and Indigenous issues for the CBC. So that was a great interview as well. Finally, I want to thank you, everyone who came to this exhibit, everyone who's come to these virtual tours and watched me walk around the gallery and talk about this exhibit. I could do this for hours at a time because it's just so much fun. But thank you for coming virtually, coming to the exhibit in person. Darvin, do you want to turn around and just show? This is, I think, really cool. One of the coolest things that we had is this. We had sort of an activity table over here when we could do, you know, more hands-on things at the museum. And this is all artwork that kids, mostly kids, maybe some adults as well, did some artwork that they did inspired by pieces in the exhibit. And so I just wanted to mention that because that was so cool. We really appreciate everybody's support. And again, post your questions or comments, and may the force be with you always.